I have a follow-up video to an unboxing. Stick around and see what I've got to show you. Well, you all saw me do the unboxing out in the truck for JJ's 40,000 giveaway. And, in retrospect, the lighting wasn't all that great. So it'd be kind of hard for y'all to have seen stuff. And I said I would go over things in greater detail later. This is later. Let us start off with the knife and sheath combination. Now, as you all saw, or maybe you didn't, I don't know. When I unboxed the knife, it came in this very nice black leather sheath. Now, I'm not going to pitch this out. I'm going to save this for a more dressy appearance. Not that I ever go out dressy. Very rarely. But I will save it just in case for such an event. The nice leather sheath, why ruin it? And I'm just that kind of person. I would probably end up ruining it if I used it for anything but dressy. So instead, I will use the Kydex sheath, much more to my usability level. Now, the first thing I did when I got this was I swapped out the fire steel, ferrule rod. I had the exact same ferrule rod that Joshua put on here on my little pack. So what I did is I took the used one and put on here for now and put the brand new one away for later. Otherwise, it's exactly the same ferrule rod. A Coglins, I believe this is. And that's all set and good to go. Then we have the headlamp. And this is a northbound train, and I never did see JJ do a review on these, on this one, and I will cut in at the end of the video footage of this headlamp being used at nighttime. Though it's kind of hard to get truly dark here and where I'm living because we got street lamps everywhere, but I'll do the best I can. Maybe I'll take a walk down to the tunnel down below me. Now this paper, damn, maybe I need that magnifying glass to read it. Where did I put that thing? There it is. It's tough when you get old and have old eyes. Okay. This says 1 powered LED. Okay, that means the big one in the center. Big LED in the center. On high power, it's good for 40 minutes on the set of batteries. Oh! Some fuzz stuck to it. That helps. Get that off of there. 40 minutes on high power. On maximum. Okay, what is this, 6M, 40? That's not making any sense. It's giving two separate times. Oh, on high power, a maximum of 40 minutes and a minimum of 6 minutes for the master, for the large LED. It might help if I take it out so you can see what I'm talking about. See, this apparently has 4 LEDs. Has 2 little white ones on either side, the large one in the center, and it's got a little tiny red light. Yeah. Now, on medium power, it's good for... Oh, wait a minute. I'm reading this wrong. Okay. All right. double-powered LED lamps, not the single. Or when one double-powered or two single-powered. Got it. Okay, so the one double-powered LED lamp, and it has three settings, minimum, maximum, and T, whatever T means. Not real sure yet. It does not, the center one on T does not do it at all. Maximum power is 40 minutes, minimum power is 6 minutes. That makes no sense at all. Minimum is good for 6 minutes and maximum for 40 minutes. I'm thinking maybe this is Chinese made and they didn't speak English so good. Maybe. And then it says 30 minutes on T, 29 minutes on maximum, and 5 minutes on minimum. This chart doesn't make any sense whatsoever. Okay, distances with fresh batteries. And then it says something in several different languages as well. Okay, now the two side lights, it's talking about they're good for between 10 and 30 hours on T. M is meters, that's what it is. Gotcha, okay. Minimum is good on the big lamp, on minimum power is good to out to 6 meters, and on maximum is good out to 40 meters. For almost zero time. That's what the T is time. I got to figure it out. And then on, I guess that'd be on medium power. It's 30 hours out to 5 and 20 meters. Minimum, maximum. And on low power, 10 hours. Okay, that makes no sense either. Why would minimum power be less than maximum power? Or medium power? Yeah, it don't matter. The point is, it's got three brightness settings. Minimum, medium, and maximum. And minimum's pretty faint. I've tried it a little bit. And the red. All that's going to be good for is up-close map reading. I've already looked at that, too. Now, this thing weighs 54 grams, plus three batteries at 36 grams, a grand total of 90 grams. The Graham Weenies would love it. Thank you very much to Mr. Hiram Cook for that phrase. I love it. Yes, I stole it from him. Speaking of that, where is Hiram? Does anybody know? I haven't seen him in almost a year. Well, maybe not quite a year, but it seems like it. Well, anyhow, we will add on some footage of this outside in the dark at the end, tail end. Now, where did I put that little baggie for this thing? Son of a... Gota. Oh, I better be careful. That'll start a fire if I'm not careful. Yeah. I'll have to figure out where that baggie went afterwards. There it is. Oh, I have a pest. Requiring attention. Oh my goodness, this is Miss Lily again. Oh, she wanted my attention. Love on me, Daddy. Headbutting my shin. Purr. Watch her front paws, folks. Kneading the bread on my tummy. aren't you, Cat, kneading the bread on my tummy? And you know I don't appreciate that at all. Goodbye. What do we have next here? Well, I'm not going to bring this out of the baggie. Foil Mylar Rescue Blanket. Quiet, easy rescue blanket provides compact emergency protection in all weather conditions. Made of durable insulation Mylar material. Retains reflects 90% of body heat. Waterproof and weatherproof. Well, I have some definite thoughts on this idea about Mylar. Don't get me wrong. Don't misunderstand the thing I'm about to say. Mylar is a useful item to have when you're out in the woods. But as I was giving someone information the other day, even sent them some links. Back in the 90s, they came out with food defrosting tray. Damn, that's good tea. Now, granted, those were black, not silvery, but they were still the same thing. They were aluminum. And that's what a Mylar blanket is, an aluminized polyethylene sheet. Pure and simple. When you put something warm on aluminum, what happens is the warmer, whatever's warmest, the heat is moved from warm to cold. It will always be so. That's just the nature of how it works. I'm not a scientist. I'm not going to try and explain it beyond that. That's why those defrosting trays work. You put cold fish or cold chicken on the tray. The room is warm. The aluminum conducts the heat from the room into the cold spot, and thereby neutralizing the cold, and more cold goes into the aluminum from the... It just causes the food to defrost faster. Well, suppose you're in sub-zero temperature and you're wrapping up in this, expecting this to keep you warm in a blizzard. It's not going to. What's going to happen is the aluminum that's on the plastic is going to take the body heat that touches it and disperse it to the cold. Take your heat and put it into the atmosphere. And faster. Now, that said, why do you think Mylar is given to marathoners at the end of the race? To help disperse their heat faster, but yet keep them from getting super chilled by breeze. A clear plastic sheet would do the same thing to keep them from getting hypothermia from a breeze on a warm sunny day. Yes, you can get hypothermia on a warm sunny day. Marathoners do, that's why they give them these things. It's not because of the Mylar, because of the silver. That's going to disperse heat from their body. But it does it in a more controlled way. The plastic sheeting keeps them from getting hypothermia from the wind. So like I said, very useful thing to have, as long as you understand the properties behind how it works. It reflects heat, yes. Used as a ceiling liner for your tarp. It does a real good job of reflecting the radiant heat coming off your fire back down to you. It'll do that, and do it well. But to wrap it up around you, it's going to make you colder. Pure and simple. Now, I was commenting to somebody the other day. They had one of these. And I said, this is nice, but they set it up like this with the crenellations around the top. Should be like so, with crenellations around the bottom. We use a windbreak to stop the wind from putting out the fire of an alcohol stove, or to keep it from blowing the flames on one of these. Okay. But you still have to allow some airflow to create convection. And that's why the little crenellations are on the bottom. To allow a small amount of the wind to pass through to create a convection. This, however, is going to going to prove very handy. Now, somebody said that these things are meant to be feet. I don't think so. Because if you notice, let us take these pins out first and foremost. Take them both out. Let us look here. These things are set to line up like so. So, if we stand this puppy up and we line them up, and I'm not going to say this is an easy thing to do, and we start the pin down through the top one, there you go. That's why it's there, and you have a spare. That is there to create a complete and continuous wall. Now, you can leave it open and just leave your pins in each side. You can. And I'm not saying you shouldn't. And I'm not saying you should necessarily connect it and create a circle. I'm saying that's what it's designed for. And look at that. I did that without any instructions with it. I had simply noticed the way those pin locations lined up and put two and two together. And as JJ said, this is not the strongest of bags, but it'll do for now. I may end up making a leather variation down the road. Then we have this nice little stove that JJ sent me. It's a Coglins. I think that's a Coglins. Yep, there it is. That's what I was looking for, Coglins. With the 24 tablets. Now this is just a bit bigger than the one I already have, which I also got from, drum roll, Hiram Cook. Yeah, he did his, the one he sent me, he did up with a Zabaton pillow. But, this is a bigger, heavier duty version, and will work well under bigger pots. I'm going to leave this out for a minute, whilst I fish this out. Now this is a nice little cook kit that JJ sent along in this kit. Let's lay that out better than that. Now this is the pot. Two bowls. I didn't take much time to show this off, the ladle. And a sponge. Now I had mentioned that this lid way too small for the fry pan, and how I thought I might have a lid that might work on the fry pan. Ta-da! Told you I had a lid that would probably fit. I may end up taking this handle off of it and putting something a little simpler on here, like just a simple knob. But, mind you, it's not a perfect fit, but it is a close enough fit that it'll work. What do you want for free? That's what that was, free. But anywho, now that's the thing. This pot, the handles kind of lock out. The fry pan, nope, they don't lock. I'm not sure why. And these plastic handles, I'm not sure how well they're going to hold up over fire. I may end up taking that plastic off after time, maybe. Don't know yet. We'll see. And this thing is I'm not too sure about those plastic bowls either. Anyhow. Oh, I was going to say. I'm not sure how that pot's going to fit. Yeah. I'm going to have this closed up part of the way like so. That pot to be able to stand on that. The fry pan, I think, will stand on it just fine. With it wide open. And if you're frying, that's probably a good thing. Frying or baking pancakes. Yes, boys and girls, it's called baking, not frying pancakes. Just like you bake bannock over an open fire. I still ain't figured out what the color name on this paracord is, but I will before too much longer. A9, maybe called A9, I'm not sure. And that's just their address and phone number for Ultimate Survival Technologies. Do not use for climbing. No kidding. Though I'm sure I could, if I doubled it over, have a 50-foot rappel line if I needed to in an emergency. I mean, if it was a case of that or a grizz having my liver for dinner, I think I'd take the chance on the paracord. Tease out cord. Threads for... Oh, core threads for fishing. Yeah, okay. Well, that's a given. Yeah, there's nothing on here that says anything about the color pattern. I will figure that out, and I may notate it down in the bottom in the more info notes. Let's get a whiff of this stuff here, huh? See, I had closed all this stuff up in the box, and it started smelling like fatwood again when I wrapped it up tight. Talk about some bacon. Wow. There are 3, 6, 7 pieces in here. Very nice. If I weren't in the house, I might scrape some down and give it a light. But the spouse is in the other room and she wouldn't appreciate that at all. And I think that was it. Yes, it is. So, like I said, I'm going to put a short clip at the end of everything put together in one spot, and then I'll add a clip of me lighting up the headlamp at nighttime out here. Let's see what I can see with that. So for now, that's a more thorough unboxing. I'm going to do this just real short and close up, handheld. Now, I showed you this lid earlier in the video, and I said I was going to take off this plastic lid. Well, I've done that, and I've modified the lid. See, I haven't quite finished it yet. I'm going to have a flat bar going across here, or maybe I'll make it some kind, something like this. And then there was this hole here. Now, the idea was
this lid, when it had this handle, had this little slider thing here. So you could slide it closed. You could slide it this way and have it open to let steam out. It was a vent. And I chose not to maintain this plastic handle because it's really huge. Can you see the difference? So I made a vent closure out of some stainless material I had. I just put a rivet through it there. Now if I want to use this to bake with on that little fry pan, I can close this vent and put hot coals on top. And then I'll be able to lift it once I put a thing over here between those two bolts with a couple of nuts. See, because there was a second hole over here that was also a vent, I don't need it. If I want a vent for baking or frying, I can just slide that open. That's all. This makes it a far more compact deal. I may turn these over and put them facing down into the lid instead of, ooh, shiny. Instead of having the screw heads in here, I may turn that over and have them face the other way, but I haven't yet determined that yet. So far, that's where I'm at. Matter of fact, that would make it far more compact, and then I could trim these down a bit. There we have it. The beginnings of a new lid system to go with that fry pan. What do you think of that, JJ? Okay, to give you a clue, it's not a very dark night out. Lots of lights around where I'm at. So, this is not the best possible. Now that's 360 degrees around my parking lot. Now I'm going to turn on this headlamp. Okay, that's on the twin beams. That's on the main beam. Down to dim. Let's light up this truck with it. It's on dim, on main beam. And there's on the high beam. Now my camera phone is not doing this justice. But there's the length of the van lit up, as best as this headlight can do for this camera. It's fairly bright up close. But the camera says, not so much. But I tell you, I can see that van just as clear as daylight almost. And then we got, see, it's not even enough to light up those vehicles down there. Lights up their taillights, but the camera can't pick them up. I can see them clear as day with this headlamp. So this is a pretty good headlamp for what we do, lads. See, in this dark car, this camera just does not do justice to how much light this headlamp is throwing. I wish it would, and I don't have better to do with, so there we have it. And then of course we've got the red mode. Let's see if I can get it to go to red mode. There we go. Got it on red. There's my hand in the red beam. So like I say, that's good for like reading a map, but not much else. And it certainly doesn't do much justice to this light out here. So there we have it.
By the way, don't forget to
thank you.